It was amazing to see the people's response to it. It's a totally created creature interrelating with humans.
Yeah.
Seamless.
That's funny. I mean, the fans hated it. But the fans hated Jar Jar before the movie even came out. Before they even knew what he was.
Why did they hate him before?
They don't like comic sidekicks. They just can't take it. You know, in the first film, nobody liked 3PO. They couldn't stand him. You know, it was like, you know, the most repulsive character ever created on film. And then we went on to, when we did The Empire, nobody liked Yoda. You know, you can't understand what he's saying, he talks backwards.
Syntax have none.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's like, oh, you know, it's terrible. And then in the third one, they hated the Ewoks. They just couldn't stand them. They were too cute, too fuzzy.
They wanted, you know, gremlins, they wanted that.
Well, they want something nasty and mean. And, you know, so it's sort of inevitable that the smallest, sort of goofiest character
gets despised,
you know, hated by, you know, because they want to, a lot of the fans are sort of into Terminator 2. And it's like, how dare you make this into a children's film? I say, hey, guys,
can't you have everybody look like Darth Maul?
Yeah, that's exactly what they want.
I want a Maori.
Right around the time I hit 11 years old, my mom would rent 3 VHS tapes from our local movie rental store. I'm not going to pull one of those back in my day kind of speeches. I think everybody knows what a video rental store is, and I think everybody knows what a VHS tape is. The movie was Star Wars. She told me it was magical, about heroes saving princesses.
I'm Luke Skywalker, I'm here to rescue you.
Epic sword fights.
You have learned much, young one.
You'll find I'm full of surprises.
I was promised that I would fall in love. I sat down on my home 70-inspired gray carpet, leaned in, not knowing or realizing the impact one franchise would have on my life. The title scrolled and the movie played, I thought to myself, this sucks, I want to go play with my toys. If you thought that people freaking out over the sequel trilogy, Rey and Kylo Ren and Luke drinking milk and all that, was the first Star Wars drama, boy, do I have a story to tell you.
It was 1977 when the world became alive, a sci-fi movie so profound. Then 20 long years later, it all became a lie when they changed it all around. On steps on Jabba's tail, the old versions are for sale.
A worthless piece of the worst thing I've ever seen in freaking Star Wars.
Everybody is
the worst
thing
I've ever seen.
If you're confused by my opening, don't be. And no, I'm not trying to be contrarian. I really didn't give a shit about the original trilogy. The puppets, the Ewoks, the lousy fights, the out-of-context storytelling, no. My love of Star Wars didn't happen until I hit 13 and a little movie called The Phantom Menace came out. Sure, I already knew what Star Wars was at the time, but the prequels made me fall in love. It gave me context. Obi-Wan wasn't just some old man fighting in a bathrobe. He was a badass Jedi cutting people in half. Wait, nope, not that. You gotta go back a little earlier. Yes, there we go. And don't worry, we'll get to the Obi-Wan show in good time. Where was I? Yes, context. Darth Vader wasn't just some guy in a black suit BDSMing his employees. He was a sympathetic kid who loved spinning, I guess?
I'll try spinning, that's a good trick.
The Jedi Council wasn't just some story being told by a green puppet.
For 800 years have I trained Jedi. I don't count to where I keep my history trained.
For me, The Phantom Menace made the original trilogy whole, as if an important piece had always been missing. and for all of its faults, namely Jar Jar.
Ooh, Jar Jar. Everyone hates you but me.
George Lucas's prequels is what took me to a galaxy far, far away. And for the record, I like Jar Jar. For those of you who don't know, the Star Wars prequels were lambasted by a large group of nerds, and I missed the whole fight, while the world ranted about Jar Jar and boring Senate sequences.
Amendments? Regulatory agencies? What the fuck, bud?
Don't worry, they're just getting the plot out of the way so it won't slow down the pew, pew, pew.
I sat blissfully unaware, just waiting for the next movie to come out. This ignorance, I believe, saved me from the possibility of strong online influence telling me I should be upset over a child's acting.
I'm a pilot, you know, and someday I'm gonna fly away from this place.
You're a pilot?
Mm-hmm. All my life.
Please. That's pretty much the Phantom Menace. After that, they go to Tatooine so they can meet a really bad kid actor who is gonna be Darth Vader because he's Anakin Skywalker. Which, I don't get the point of this. Why not just make Anakin 17 years old like Luke? Then we could relate to him. We can kind of follow his story. Instead, he's this kid, which we don't care about. And he's gonna be an adult in the next movie, so why even have him a kid?
Or that Jar Jar was a racist stereotype.
Jim Jam, what happened to the wheel covers on my landing gear?
Misa sell them to buy Misa some space bliff!
Character is just a tired stereotype.
In any case, we get down to Naboo, the main planet in this movie, and we meet Jar Jar Binks. Now, when I first met Jar Jar Binks, I was like, this guy is nothing like I thought he was gonna be. I don't know what I thought Jar Jar Binks was going to be like. I just didn't think he would be Jar Jar Binks. I didn't think he'd set black people back 50 years, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
I didn't hear any of this. I would, however, discover a love of Star Wars, a thirst that could only be quenched by anything and everything Star Wars related. I read Splinter of the Mind's Eye. I played every game I could get my hands on. And yes, I rewatched the original trilogy. And then it finally hit me. I understood why my mom fell in love all those years ago. Star Wars became the most important thing in my life. I wanted to know everything about everything. How the Force worked, what powers did a Jedi have. Luckily, I had a friend who lived a few blocks away who fancied himself well-versed in Star Wars lore. He would introduce me to Star Wars literature, namely the X-Wing series, and from there, I will go down a rabbit hole that there was no escape from. And while I can't confirm that everything he told me was fact, it set the groundwork for what I would recognize years later as being one of the worst parts of the Star Wars fan base. Gatekeeping.
Well, so it looked like what you'd expect from an SNL skit. It's like two actors who barely comprehend what they're supposed to be doing against a really bad green screen in horrible costumes with horrible hair and makeup, going through lines that don't make any sense. And it just, how did Star Wars get to this? How did this become what Star Wars is supposed to be?
Star Wars fans sure do like to tell you what is and isn't right in Star Wars.
But the people that are trying to make excuses for this bullshit, acting as if it doesn't just completely break continuity. You know, Disney Star Wars is lucky that they have these people to run defense for them, that they will literally lap up shit and pretend it's fucking good. You cannot convince any rational person that they had this type of relationship, and then all of a sudden A New Hope comes along and you get that message from Bail Organa to Obi-Wan Kenobi relayed through Leia, and then that there's literally no remorse, no grief, no nothing when Obi-Wan Kenobi dies on the Death Star.
These are the people that will defend this are the same kind of people that will get that line when Obi-Wan meets Luke for the first time and goes, hello there. You know, and they clap like mindless seals. Like that's as far as their like appreciation of something like this goes. It's like, he said the line.
Ever since The Last Jedi, there has been a rise in gatekeeping idiots who hate Disney Star Wars but keep watching Disney Star Wars. Now, make no mistake, there is profit in being negative.
It's profitable to be positive and talk highly of the sequels.
No, actually, totally the opposite. It's so much more profitable to be hateful and stoke the flames and embers, to constantly shit on things. If you're constantly complaining about things, you actually get more money and you get more views. 100%. Because it's dramatic. People want that.
I don't get the hate. But like I said, anger is monetizable. I've seen it myself.
my views have declined a lot since not reviewing movies I didn't like anymore. And I've had to sit back and examine what my position was in that happening and really wonder if I had an impact on that and completely change myself as a result, because I don't like the way this platform's going. I don't like the way the discourse around certain fandoms is going.
These guys see the online audience that they can cultivate around the hate that Disney Star Wars seems to get. And it didn't start with channels like Critical Drinker or Nerdrotic. This hate goes way back to the very origins of Star Wars and is kept alive basically all this time. Even when faced with the hypocrisy of their own logic, let's take one of the commentators on the last clip I just showed you, RK Outpost, who claims that because the Obi-Wan show shows Leia building an early relationship with Kenobi, this somehow means that she should have had a more sympathetic response in A New Hope when Ben sacrifices himself to Vader. Instead, we see her consoling Luke. It's not like there are other major continuity errors in the other films like Revenge of the Sith that we could dissect, but yet here we are, and yes, there is. Now, first of all, how does RK Outpost feel about Revenge of the Sith?
And Revenge of the Sith was this culmination of, you know, so many years, you know, wrapped all up into this one movie. And whether you want to say the acting, there's some parts, okay, I get you. But for me, I absolutely love Revenge of the Sith. And if you asked me to put in a Star Wars movie, it'd probably be Revenge of the Sith.
Well, since he loves Revenge of the Sith so much, and since he has so much respect for the original trilogy, this scene in Return of the Jedi must really, really confuse him.
Leia, do you remember your mother?
Just a little bit. She died when I was very young.
What do you remember?
Just images, really. Feelings.
Tell me.
She was very beautiful, kind, but sad.
Well, that's funny. How does Leia remember her mother when her mother died on a birthing table? Sounds like a continuity error. And just remember, Luke was born first.
Luke.
It's a girl.
So let's check in with RK Outpost and see just how important continuity is to him.
The thing is, the people that will accept this, that will excuse away the contradictions and the breaks in canon, they'll excuse away another season and another season and another season. Oh, because yeah. If him and Darth Vader fought twice, what's another time? Like, honestly, if that's the mindset they have, who the fuck cares? Have them fight again all the way up till a week before A New Hope. What does it fucking matter at this point?
Flashback.
But for me, I absolutely love Revenge of the Sith.
A few moments later.
Idea that Bail Organa, they now have evidence that Bail Organa is communicating with Obi-Wan Kenobi. They know that Leia was saved by Obi-Wan Kenobi, that there is this connection there. And in 10 years, they do nothing about it. Bail Organa is allowed to continue his political career when he would be assassinated immediately. Leia is allowed to have a Senate seat. Are you kidding me? None of this makes sense.
So let me get this straight. You don't have any issues with continuity problems so long as it's in a movie that you like, a movie that you enjoyed when you were a kid. But as soon as it enters any other Star Wars project, then you have a big fucking problem. See, this is why I don't take these guys seriously, because they don't take themselves seriously. They're a bunch of whiny fucking babies. And you know what we do with whiny fucking babies?
You know how you handle an actor? They whine about anything. You pull down their pants and you their ass.
You spanked that ass, Les.
What?
And can we please stop fucking pretending like everything in the old canon was the greatest thing to have ever been made? The Heir to the Empire series had Luke fighting a Luke clone. Fucking stupid. Kyle Katarn trained himself as a Jedi, the embodiment of a Gary Stu. No one cared. Imagine if Lucasfilm made a game about Broom Boy training himself. You all would have a fucking collective aneurysm. Sith statues coming to life? Stupid. The Valley of the Jedi? Really? What is this, Highlander? Luke had a giant lizard for an apprentice, and 2 out of 3 of Han and Leia's kids were killed off, leaving just the female, Jaina, alive. But these guys don't have issues with female leads.
God, they're all women. They're all women!
There's a reason
why. Pause it for a second. Pause it.
pause it.
It's been a while.
Did all the men die? Is that what happened?
Yeah. Okay. All of the guys for the show are gone.
I just wanted to check.
All right, Ezra's so to be as charitable as possible,
okay,
the
Ryan.
Story they're telling is the aftermath of Rebels, in which Ahsoka, Sabine, and Hera are supposed to go find Ezra. So you have all the women collectively from Rebels that are supposed to go and save the man, Ezra, because the other man died, Kanan.
Ahsoka series, good women versus bad men. That's what it is.
And if by some chance RK Outpost is listening to this, hey man, you like the prequels when you were a kid, right? Yeah, no shit.
The idea was simply to do a high adventure film that I loved when I was a kid with meaningful psychological themes. You know, it's hard for people to realize, and I'm not supposed to say this, and I wasn't supposed to say it then, but, you know, it's a film for 12-year-olds.
I don't think that RK Outpost is evil. I just think that he's bought into this bullshit narrative. I would recommend to him to go back to the origins of his love for Star Wars.
Someone who grew up with the prequels, you know, as they were coming out. I was 11 when The Phantom Menace came out. I think I was like 16 when Revenge of the Sith came out. I have a great love for the prequels, and they're really what got me into Star Wars.
Now, if RK Outpost still wants to rant about unrealistic Star Wars lore, then maybe we should be talking about the original trilogy and the horridly unrealistic final battle.
It was I who allowed the Alliance to know the location of the shield generator. It is quite safe from your pitiful little band. An entire legion of my best troops awaits them. Best troops.
And this isn't just the fans. The people who are directly involved with Disney Star Wars are a part of the madness too. And it's fucking annoying. Take a somewhat recent rant by Rebels voice actor Freddie Prinze Jr.
I did a Star Wars cartoon, so even I get hate from Star Wars fans when I'm like, look, dog, you're just mad the franchise isn't aging with you.
Right.
And all these video games have fucked people up on what the Force is. Like, Luke's skill doesn't dictate whether he wins or loses.
Right.
The Emperor doesn't dictate whether he wins or loses. The Force dictates who wins or loses based on balance. These are George Lucas's words, not mine. So fuck you if you disagree with me. Straight up, this is information, not affirmation time. Straight up, man. Again. Not my opinion, George Lucas's. So go fuck yourself if you disagree. You don't get to level up in the Star Wars world. That's a fucking video game. There's no such thing as a gray Jedi.
Where do I even begin? First of all, yes, there are power levels in Star Wars. And no, this isn't me gatekeeping. How do I know this? I watched Star Wars.
I've been looking forward to this.
My powers have doubled since the last time we met, Count.
Good. Twice the pride, double the fall.
Yes, there are power levels. It's literally in the movies. You can even tell how powerful a Force user is by a DNA test.
Obi-Wan?
Yes, Master.
I need an analysis of this blood sample I'm sending you.
Wait a minute.
I need a midichlorian count.
The reading is off the chart. Over 20,000.
Even Master Yoda doesn't have a midichlorian count that high.
No Jedi has.
What does that mean?
I'm not sure.
As if each person has a force meter bar next to their head. Yes, it's like a video game, and that's okay. And I understand that Freddie Prinze Jr. may have a lot more insider's knowledge than the rest of us, but it's these types of rants that ruin Star Wars for the casual fan. And this is rampant within the Star Wars, and I'll use verbal air quotes, fandom. A more recent example of this is Star Wars Theory. This is a channel and a guy, as of filming this, that has the largest online Star Wars community. And within this cesspool, you will never find a more wretched hive of scum and villainy. And while I don't watch this channel anymore, the Star Wars gatekeeping extends into just about every area of Star Wars.
Grews, and it all comes from a live stream involving YouTuber Star Wars Theory, in which he said,
"It's just whatever. It's honestly a kind of a forgettable show. Look, acting was great. Cinematography was great. The writing was good. But it was a lot of little things. I mean, when we saw the camera in the previous episode, there were like screws in the wall. When we see certain architecture, it's just bricks. You know, it's not smooth stone or sandstone or whatever it might be that was in the prequels or the originals, which kind of gives you the feel of Star Wars. The whole thing about Star Wars is to feel like it's from a galaxy far, far away. It didn't do that."
Does Star Wars Theory not understand that this scene in Episode 2 is a real place? This isn't in a galaxy far, far away. It's Lake Como. I can understand that Star Wars does have a sort of expected aesthetic, but even things that are strange to me, like the biker gang in the Book of Boba Fett series, is fine, because I understand that as Star Wars expands, it's going to incorporate things that are new to me, just like previous canon. But this is lost on some, and that's where the hate starts to come out.
You're blending so many emotions, and it's easy for people to... Like, for me, for someone who doesn't acknowledge the sequels as being canon, it's my opinion, it's not yours, don't worry about it.
The fucking entitlement these people have. And if Star Wars Theory thinks his words don't have impact, with a channel of over 3 million subscribers, this type of rhetoric breeds cesspool hate groups. And it also sets themselves up for future misery, as whether he likes it or not, the sequel trilogy is canon and it isn't going anywhere, and the shows that are all playing now are all going to lead to it. But this guy takes it one step further.
Lucas created. And for this company to come along and destroy such characters is really blasphemous in a lot of ways, because a lot of people see Star Wars as a religion. They see it as a higher power.
Star Wars is a movie for kids, not a higher power. Jesus fucking Christ.
Before I even get started, I just need to say, on behalf of like all the Star Wars fans of my generation, welcome back to the franchise. Dude, like, I grew up, like, you're my generation of Star Wars. So I'm like, I do a lot of interviews, but I'm like super giddy about this one.
Oh man, I really appreciate that. Thank you. I'm only in the last, you know, few years sort of aware of the generation who we made those films for, you know, like the love that there is for the prequels, you know, because at the time it didn't feel like that. When they came out, they were sort of, I suppose the movie critics were a little sniffy about them. And so it's really nice now to feel that sort of warmth for them. It's great.
Yeah, no.
It's a lot to us.
No, 10-year-old me was not listening to the critics. He was eating it up. So.
It seems that some of the fan base from this influential fan base have decided to attack Moses Ingram online and send her the most horrendous racist DMs. And I heard some of them this morning and it just broke my heart. Moses is a brilliant actor. She's a brilliant woman. And she's absolutely amazing in this series. She brings so much to the series. She brings so much to the franchise. And it just sickened me to my stomach to hear that this had been happening. I just want to say, as the leading actor in the series, as the executive producer in the series, that we stand with Moses. We love Moses. And if you're sending her bullying messages, you're no Star Wars fan in my mind. There's no place for racism in this world.
If you want to know where the hate for Star Wars comes from, hate for characters, new characters, characters brought to live action, it comes from bullshit like this.
That explains Amanda. These three.
Where's yeah. Hera's kid that she had with
Jason? Hina? I hope he fucking died, to be honest. I hope that he's not in the story. It's just another Star Wars Expanded Universe abomination to give him the name of Jason.
We mocked this, right? Before this show even came out, we talked about this, and we said, this is going to culminate in Reva having either Obi-Wan or Luke at her mercy. She'll have beaten everyone, and she's got the opportunity to win everything, and she'll then have her change of heart and be like, no, I can't do this. And like, everything that happened in the Star Wars OT is because of this one diverse female space Jesus, who's just like Michael Burnham from Star Trek. That's what they're setting her up as. I guarantee it. That's why they've come out so fucking hard to defend this character and this actress, because they know exactly what they're going to do with her.
Yeah, and it's going to be.
I mean, how do you even address bullshit like this? You see channels shamelessly judging content before it even comes out, and then brag about it like it's a badge of honor. These guys had made up their mind on who Reva was going to be in the Kenobi series, and no matter how it turned out, even if they were dead wrong, they would morph their opinions to mask the fact that they created drama around a character that wound up not being betrayed in the way that they ranted about. The only thing that they called that wound up being correct was Reva not killing Luke, but they made a lot of predictions, and most of them were wrong. Reva was not a strong female antagonist. In fact, she was the weakest character in the series, being thrown around not only by Vader himself, but also the fifth brother. She could barely hold her own against Owen and Beru. I mean, two farmers held their ground against her. Reva was a sad tragedy character. She was not manipulated by anybody. She willingly joined the Inquisitors to get close to Vader. She didn't beat Obi-Wan, and she was so unthreatening to Vader that he literally defeated her without having to use his own lightsaber. And while Star Wars is filled with last-minute redemptive arcs, Darth Vader gets to spend the rest of his life in Force Paradise because he kills his boss? Really? But you won't hear these guys complaining about Vader's redemption. You won't hear them complaining about Darth Maul surviving being cut in half, because guess what? Darth Maul is a popular character, and these guys are too cowardly to stand by their own principles. In fact, surviving lightsaber stabs and being cut in half is grounded in past Star Wars lore. Ma from the Dark Forces series was cut in half, and Kyle Katarn was stabbed in the chest by Jason Solo. Both of them survived their injuries. But yes, let's complain about Reva surviving multiple stab wounds. And believe it or not, there is actually a technical term for things like this. It is called projection. This is when you rant and bitch about things that you yourself are doing. And nothing exemplifies this better than a shitpost by YouTuber Critical Drinker, who rants about the Kenobi series only halfway through.
What all this comes down to is another little phrase that started to pop up quite a bit in recent years. Crafting the narrative.
Flashback.
Let's apply the formula, gentlemen. Yeah. So she is a strong female character who's in service of bad people. Obviously, she can't actually be evil. What we'll actually find out is that she's a good person underneath it all, who's been manipulated into doing this by an evil person, an evil man. And she will redeem herself.
See, most people aren't really driven by dry facts and figures and data points, because those things have to be studied in detail and understood and interpreted, and all of that takes time and effort, and that's a real problem.
Flashback.
Yeah. We mocked this, right? Before the show even came out, we talked about this, and we said this is going to culminate in Reva having either Obi-Wan or Luke at her mercy. She'll have beaten everyone, and she's got the opportunity to win everything, and she'll...
You know what it'll be? It's like she'll beat Obi-Wan Kenobi to within an inch of his life, and she'll have it at her mercy, and then she'll be like, no, I can't kill you.
He's gonna be like, I'm watch good. Over Luke.
What they need instead is something that generates a visceral emotional reaction to get them engaged.
Flashback.
Is saying like everything that happened in the Star Wars OT is because of this one diverse female space Jesus who's just like Michael Burnham from Star Trek. That's what they're setting her up as. I guarantee it. That's why they've come out so fucking hard to defend this character and this actress, because they know exactly what they're going to do with her.
Yeah, and she's going to be likely
to end all retcons, I guarantee you.
A series of extreme sensationalized examples strung together into a simple, cohesive, easy-to-digest opinion.
Ahsoka series, good women versus bad men. That's what it is.
i.e. a narrative. And if that opinion happens to line up with what they already believe, because they've been told the same thing by a bunch of other sources, then so much the better.
And if Critical Drinker is actually watching this, I refuse to believe that you're this stupid. You and I both know that Disney is responding to the actual hate Moses Ingram got.
There's nothing anybody can do about this. There's nothing anybody can do to stop this hate. And so I question what my purpose is in even being here in front of you saying that this is happening.
Real racists sent real messages to Moses Ingram, so I don't know what the fuck you were talking about internalizing it like this was an attack on some fringe group that was unhappy with the Kenobi series.
Every single time, the same accusations of bigotry and toxicity get flung around like monkeys throwing their poo at each other. But what does any of this actually accomplish, except to piss off and alienate the very people that you're trying to appeal to?
Now look, I don't know. I mean, maybe Critical Drinker really is drunk when he makes his videos. So I will try to give him and the rest of his ilk the benefit of the doubt. The reason you are lumped in with these Disney-identified unsavory characters is because of shit like this.
Yeah. We mocked this, right? Before the show even came out, we talked about this.
You provide two opposing narratives. On one face, you act as if you make your decisions off data and analysis. But on the other, you judge things before you ever watch them, you fucking idiot. The lack of self-awareness and overall hypocrisy is astonishing, but we've been talking a lot about Obi-Wan. What about the sequel trilogy? In my mind, the hate the sequel trilogy got was simple. Disney completely rewrote the franchise, and this hate wasn't more obvious than when The Last Jedi aired in 2017.
Potential of your bloodline. A new Vader.
To truly understand why people hated this version of Luke Skywalker, you have to understand what Disney killed off. In the Legends canon, this is everything prior to Disney's buyout, Luke Skywalker was a hopeful Jedi Master, married to a woman named Mara Jade, of which the two had a son named Ben. Han and Leia had three kids, Jason, Jaina, and Anakin, and Chewie died before Han. They basically rewrote everything, scrapping just about every plot thread that had been carefully constructed over a long period of time by brilliant writers like Timothy Zahn, who arguably wrote some of the greatest Star Wars novels ever penned, the Heir to the Empire series. Han's son in the Disney movie, Kylo Ren, was basically an amalgamation of Jason and Anakin. Jason Solo, who was my favorite character, mind you, would become a Sith and be later killed by his twin sister, Jaina. It was a heartbreaking moment for me. Star Wars Theory cried when Luke made his grand entrance in The Mandalorian. I cried when Jason took his last breath. Knowing this, you can see that as The Last Jedi slugged on, people realized that any hopes of Legends continuity making its way back in was gone. It wasn't just Luke they were killing. They were killing off his wife, his son, side characters long established. And while I understand the hate, as I too wasn't the biggest fan of The Last Jedi, I was able to understand that Disney was going in a different direction. Albeit a weird one, but a different one nonetheless. The Star Wars community raised its fist and screamed, "This isn't Star Wars!" But that sentiment wasn't new. This had happened before. The generation that loved the original trilogy hated the prequels.
Star Wars The Phantom Menace was the most disappointing thing since my son. I mean, how much more could you possibly fuck up the entire backstory to Star Wars?
The generation that loved the prequels hated the sequels. It's almost poetic.
You know, kind of duplicating the Luke Skywalker role, but you see the echo of where it all is going to go. And instead of destroying the Death Star, he destroys the ship that controls the robots. Again, it's like poetry. It's sort of like they rhyme. Mm-hmm. Every stanza kind of rhymes with the last one. Hopefully it'll work.
I do not follow the Harry Potter community, nor do I follow the Star Trek world. So, I don't know about you guys, but the Star Wars fan base is insanely rife with speculation. I don't know where or when this started. My mom used to write Star Wars fan fiction when she was a teenager. I used to write Star Wars fan fiction when I was a teenager. I don't have any kids yet, but I'll assume the tradition will carry on. I think popular franchises will have their communities, but in the case of Star Wars, the loudest voices seem to be the disgruntled ones. And to me, the reason for this is simple. Negativity sells. That old saying, if it bleeds, it leads, couldn't be more true when it comes to the Star Wars community. And make no mistake, there are unmistakable villains in this story.
This is Mike Zero. Subscribe if you're new and like this video to see future Star Wars updates. I'm also on Twitter at MikeZero1. I thank you also very much for the great and kind support. This is Mike Zero. Subscribe if you're new and like this video to see future Star Wars updates. This is Mike Zero. Subscribe if you're new and like this video. This is Mike Zero.
Mike Zero is a YouTuber whose channel is based around speculation and rumors. Like him or hate him, he's popular. And what can I really say about him other than his channel boasts insider knowledge on current Star Wars trends? I don't think there's anything that mystical about him, though. Mike Zero makes a lot of content, so in the case of him, a broken clock is right twice a day. He pretty much follows popular sentiments and bases his content around that. If everyone loved Kathleen Kennedy, his videos would be about how great she is. He's unoriginal, and his clickbait thumbnails are pretty easy to see through, but for the casual viewer, they may actually think that Disney is going to reboot the sequel trilogy. Spoiler alert, they aren't. And I'm not going to tell you to not watch Mike Zero, but understand that I think speculation ruins any franchise. What did in The Last Jedi was all the endless rumors about what people thought was and wasn't going to be in the next film.
Let's go over new details of Star Wars The Last Jedi when it comes to Luke Skywalker, Rey, Kylo Ren, and the Knights of Ren. So, we will be actually describing a battle sequence in the third act of the film, all thanks to MakingStarWars.net, a very reliable Star Wars news website with excellent sources, so let's get right to it.
Everyone wanted to know who is Snoke and who are Rey's parents, and there were so many videos talking about how they believed they figured out what the next movie was going to have and that they had insider knowledge, including Mike Zero. And of course, none of this happened. So people were up in arms demanding the fan base boycott Star Wars.
What the fuck with Snoke, man? You fucked it up. You done fucked it up. It doesn't seem like he's trained him. To complete his training, kill Rey. That's the completed training. I was hoping to see montages of fucking dark side shit or, you know, just fucking... Does a little bit of force lightning. Is that what I saw? It was force lightning. We don't know nothing about his fucking rings. All the Star Wars theory channels, it's...
Speculation and rumor fueled just about every conceivable idea about what people thought The Last Jedi was going to showcase, and everybody was wrong. Theory crafting who Snoke was and what part the Knights of Ren were going to play in the next installment, only to be massively let down because none of them were right. I don't personally have any issues with people theorizing what's going to happen in a movie, but when it's done to push a narrative or to create hate around a specific character, that is where I draw the line. We are currently in a renaissance of Star Wars content, complete with amazing shows and video games. Never has there been so much offered in such little time. Make no mistake, my friends, in a couple of years, the sequel trilogy will get the same type of treatment that the prequel trilogy is getting right now. People will come out in droves to appreciate the good more than the bad. And as time slips by and we get closer and closer to the upcoming Rey movie, we can count on content creators like The Critical Drinker to give a fair and unbiased opinion.
Decision is final. Tabled, this motion is. Or is it?